Nadim Kobesi has written a paper called An Analysis of the ProtonMail Cryptographic Architecture, where he says that no end-to-end encryption guarantees have ever been provided by the ProtonMail service. This is quite a big and serious claim. End-to-end encryption is the first feature they list in their security details, along zero access to user data, which means we don't have the technical ability to decrypt your messages, and as a result, we are unable to hand your data over to third parties. With ProtonMail, privacy isn't just a promise, it is mathematically ensured. ProtonMail has been around for quite some time now. If something so fundamentally seems wrong, it must be some kind of crazy, complicated crypto attack, right? But if you read the paper, you will realize it's something fairly basic. So in this video, I want to explore one specific thing from this paper. This whole topic has caused quite some controversy, and before we head into this, I think it's just fair to disclose that I have worked with Nadim many times professionally. So you can accuse me of bias, but I don't think that this actually affects the content of this video. It was merely the reason why I paid attention to this paper in the first place. But let's not waste more time, let's head into the paper. Nadim first introduces some entities. We need to know about a ProtonMail user A and a ProtonMail user B. We also consider a ProtonMail webmail server P. So we have two ProtonMail users A and B, and they want to send an email to each other by using ProtonMail web server P. Because ProtonMail offers end-to-end encryption, this email will actually be encrypted with PGP, and there's nothing wrong with PGP. The only challenge with PGP here is the secure exchange of the public key, but we just assume keys were exchanged securely, for example A and B met in person before. So if user A encrypts the mail with the public key from user B and uses ProtonMail to transfer the mail to B, there's no security issue. End-to-end encryption is working fine. But then how can Nadim claim that no end-to-end encryption guarantees have ever been provided by the ProtonMail service? It looks all perfectly fine, right? Well, the devil is in the real-world implementation details. You see, this graph that describes the mail exchange assumes that user A and user B just have trusted implementations of PGP, the code that will do the encryption for them. However, in the web, just as a matter of fact how the web works, the program, the code that implements the encryption, the web app you use, ProtonMail, is also delivered by the ProtonMail server P. And this can be seen here in figure 2a. Before a user A can PGP encrypt the email message M for the public key from user B, it has to receive the code to do that in the browser. This is indicated here by J. J refers to the JavaScript implementation of PGP that is served by ProtonMail. And we are done. That's for me the important part of the paper, so the conclusion is simple. When ProtonMail says, we don't have the technical ability to decrypt your messages, it's kind of wrong, right? Technically, they can just deliver a malicious JavaScript JEvil that will just steal your plain text message before encryption or just straight up steal your private key. The technical ability is absolutely there. And so the claim that this end-to-end encryption is not just promised but mathematically ensured seems objectively false, no? So let's have a look at what ProtonMail has to say about that. The key question being debated is whether or not applications can constitute end-to-end encryption. Nadim's opinion is that, as he writes, no webmail-style application could. His viewpoint is that end-to-end encryption is not possible with web clients, period, end of discussion. This is a rather extreme position to take, as it would also apply to web versions of WhatsApp or Wire, for instance. Like WhatsApp and Wire, we also offer a web app. The major opinion Nadim is expressing here is that you can't do end-to-end encryption in a web app. Obviously, WhatsApp and Wire do not share this opinion. Signal coincidentally does share this opinion. We do understand Nadim's argument and agree that web apps are less secure than, say, native iOS apps. Okay, so they do somewhat agree. However, they think it's not that significant. They use the fact that WhatsApp and Wire also offer web apps as an argument for their site, but of course these are also other commercial applications that, like ProtonMail, have a user demand and an economic incentive to offer web app versions. But for a moment, let's go back to this figure. We say we have here a problem because ProtonMail server P provides the JavaScript code for the browser and could thus provide malicious code as well. But then how is this different from a mobile app? ProtonMail also provides the mobile app and the automatic updates for it. So ProtonMail could also just deliver an evil app update that steals clear text emails. And now you can actually continue with this rabbit hole. Apple offers iOS updates, which means they push the code you run on your phone. They could create an operating system update that specifically extracts the decrypted emails from the ProtonMail app and sends it away. And wait, you run this all on hardware that you bought from somewhere, and the CPU could just once in a while jump to some secret malicious code that could take the decrypted messages out of memory and steal it. You see, you can extend these circles quite far, however at some point it gets silly. While technically your hardware could be backdoored, that's very unlikely, like the recent bullshit Bloomberg story. And yes, technically Apple could push a malicious operating system update, but that is also super unrealistic. But what about ProtonMail creating a malicious mobile app update? Here we start to get into a bit more realistic realms. Build servers or web servers that offer the final software for download have been compromised before and replaced with Trojanized versions. This is something we could be concerned about. However, we also know these compromised versions are caught fairly quickly because this attack has quite some hurdles to overcome. And Nadim shares an example about the delivery process of Android apps. Simply speaking, in case of a mobile app, it's not as simple as saying that ProtonMail server P delivers it. There are developers, signing keys, app stores, and everybody gets the same new version, so overall this is very unlikely. So this leads us to the typical web applications, which are delivered from the server every time. When you access ProtonMail, we know for a fact that a lot of websites get compromised and, for example, a cryptocurrency CoinHive miners gets included in the JavaScript. So we can already see that this is a more realistic threat. And the big danger here is also that you could carefully control which user gets delivered which version. You could only target a specific IP, a region, a user, and only deliver a malicious JavaScript JEvil once. And after that, all the future requests are safe again. You see that it is very different from a malicious mobile app. And so ProtonMail questions if the line that Nadim draws here is reasonable. Can we, for the current state of our technology, say that web apps cannot implement end-to-end encryption because the code is always delivered with HTTP requests? Well, ProtonMail's argument against the paper is saying that this is just an opinion, saying that Nadim draws the line here arbitrarily. Nadim's opinion is that, as he writes, no webmail-style application could. But that is a bit unfair. This quote is not the root of Nadim's argument. It is quite an extreme position to take, but he takes his position as a result of his argument. This is Nadim's conclusion. And while I agree with the conclusion, let's not get distracted by this. Conclusions are more likely subjective, and thus ProtonMail uses it to discredit him. But Nadim wrote a paper specifically about ProtonMail, and we have to look at his actual arguments regarding ProtonMail. And more specifically, the claims that ProtonMail makes and Nadim uses to construct this argument. So ProtonMail attacks Nadim's general conclusion, but seems to ignore and sidestep the claims that lead Nadim there. But I know why. Because ProtonMail is in a predicament. They themselves acknowledge Nadim's threat in their business paper, ProtonMail Security Features and Infrastructure. They write, ProtonMail conservatively assumes that all mail servers may eventually be compromised. And even further into the paper, where they talk about how they want to protect passwords, different story, they again refer to this threat. If the server is compromised, whether from a malicious code injected onto the server or due to a blah blah unimportant. You see, ProtonMail themselves claim that ProtonMail server P is untrustworthy. And based on this claim, Nadim successfully makes the argument, well, if ProtonMail can be compromised, which they say shouldn't be a problem, the JavaScript code delivered is also compromised. ProtonMail does not make such claims about the mobile app. They don't advertise a security model where a compromised build queue, including developer signing keys, is not a problem. But they do say a compromised server P is supposed to be safe. So, as it stands, ProtonMail does not meet its self-professed security goals. Which means ProtonMail must overhaul its existing specification, documentation, and product presentation materials to reflect this matter of fact. So it doesn't mean that ProtonMail is less secure than alternatives. It simply means ProtonMail's very high security goals and public marketing claims, specifically about compromised servers, have been refuted. Nothing more, nothing less. And of course, if for you personally, a compromised ProtonMail server is not in your threat model because you trust them, then you are also fine. So I hope that ProtonMail can properly address these very specific claims and admit that in this case, their claims fall a bit short. It doesn't have to be such a big deal, but I personally would like to move away from ProtonMail now and rather generally ask, what conclusions do you draw from this? Do you agree with Nadim's radical or reasonable view that end-to-end encryption is simply not possible in this strong mathematical sense as a web app?